So my name is Brennan Boblett. I'm the Director of Product Design at Mapbox.
Yeah, hi, nice to be here. My name is Åsa Forsell, and I'm Customer Experience Manager at Rightware.
So we're here today to talk about putting humans first. And so this probably sounds familiar to everybody in the room. As designers and developers, this is what we do best, right? This is what we think about every single day. But we're here to share some perspectives on sort of how we're treating this across autonomy, HMI, and some of the tool sets to bring these experiences to life.
Yeah. Great, thank you. So there's a question that I have been wondering for a long, long time. Why is it that despite all of this amazing mapping technology that we know that exists and that we have seen here today, this is still often the best navigation system for the car, for the driver in the cars? And one might say that this is not my own personal preference, which it totally is, but the reality is that there are many other people who think the same way. And I would like to give you an example of a real-life scenario. So I'm from Finland, so it's in Northern Europe, if you don't know about it. And in Finland, we have probably the newest fleet of taxis in the entire world. And this is because the government heavily subsidizes professional drivers when they are buying new cars. So when you hop into a cab in Helsinki, it is most likely a brand new Mercedes, Audi, BMW, or even a Tesla. So you know that the car comes with all of the newest technologies and also the best possible in-car navigation systems. Still, every time, they use their mobile phones, not the in-car navigation systems. And this is not just because they are using Uber or Lyft that requires them to use their mobile phones, but because in Finland, actually, Uber and Lyft are illegal. You cannot do it. You cannot use them. So the taxi drivers are not restricted to using some sort of backend. So why is it? Why is it that they still use their mobile phones even though they have their in-car navigation systems? Well, first of all, often they are quite hard to use. And second of all, they are just simply not good enough. They are not as good as the free maps that we get with our smartphones. So does the in-car navigation have to suck? And how can we fix this? These are some of the questions that we have asked at Rightware. And at Rightware, we have revolutionized the way that OEMs create user interfaces in the automotive industry in the past years. When I started working at Rightware 4.5 years ago, we had around 2 OEMs or car manufacturers as our customers. But we asked a lot of questions. We went to the OEMs and we asked them, what is wrong? Why do the car interiors look so horrible? And what can we do to improve them? And the answers were pretty much always the same. They didn't have the tools to empower the designers to actually execute their designs because they used some legacy 2D systems and all of those were sort of impossible for the designers to use and had to be done by the application engineers who are definitely not designers. But we don't just like listening to OEMs' problems, we also like to solve them, and that is probably the reason why today we have over 35 car manufacturers as our customers and around 20 million cars running around or driving around the world with our software in it, and it's increasing all the time. And that is because of our tool. And I'm quickly going to run you through what our tool does so that you have a better understanding of what I'm going to talk about next. So Kanzi is a UI and connectivity tool that allows you to create next-generation automotive cockpits. And we have been heavily, heavily inspired by how gaming companies have been able to push out AAA games extremely fast. And they have these amazing, huge worlds with amazing technology and amazing graphics, while the car manufacturers have been struggling to push out any type of UI with graphics. Why is that? And it's because they don't have the tools to do it. So if you have ever used Unity or Unreal Engine, you probably get the gist of Kanzi pretty quick. So Kanzi has studio tool for designers and the graphical engine for the application engineers for connecting with the car. And the studio has basically a real-time rendered a preview that shows you exactly the UI. And it has all of the user, it is the user interface design and development tool. And it has hybrid 2D and 3D graphics, so you can have seamlessly 2D graphics and 3D graphics in the same world. And you can also create the user interaction for this without writing any code. And this really empowers the designers to create and execute the actual designs that they want to do. And they can also fastly prototype, so they might have an idea of how the car should interact or the human should interact with the car. And they don't have to just instead of figuring out how this could work, but they can immediately start testing and testing. And if they find out that their idea was crap, then they can scrap it, and then they can test out a new idea and prototype. And they can create prototype of UIs in a matter of hours. And then we have the runtime. And the runtime has a complete UI framework, and basically a state-of-the-art real-time rendering engine, so you could render as good graphics as any gaming engine inside the car. Unfortunately, most car manufacturers do not want to have that type of graphics in a car, or they can't because of low-cost hardware, but it's possible. And we provide an API for the application engineers to work with so that they can connect the actual design of the UI with the car and other services. And we understand that the reality is that having great UI is not enough. You also have to connect it with different things. So in the past couple of years, we have rolled out a new product called Kanzi Connect. And it's essentially a connectivity tool that you use to create this connectivity between your HMI and the car and with the rest of the world. So it's essentially an SDK that allows you to create this client-server architecture that you can use then to distribute data inside the car. So you might have, for example, a car that has a cluster and a head-up display with laser projector, an IVI system, and some mobile phones, your own personal wearables, and such. So you need to synchronize the data in all of these. But the problem is that in many cases, the cluster is made with one tool and it's running on one operating system, let's say Integrity. And then the IVI is made with another tool and it's running on a different operating system, let's say Android or Linux or what have we. So you have to seamlessly be able to connect this data, and this is what Kanzi Connect does. And this opens extremely interesting new avenues for the automotive OEMs because they can start selling new services. They can, for example, start introducing subscription models that we think of, well, obvious. We have subscription models everywhere. But in automotive, this has been quite impossible before. So let's say you buy a new car, and it's a decent mid-sized car. But you don't want to spend too much money on the features, so you don't buy the ADAS system. But the reality is that the car already comes with all of the sensors, whether you buy the ADAS system or not, because the ADAS system is just it's just a feature, it's just software. So now you have the car for a while and you're going for a long road trip. You might think, oh, I wish I had the ADAS system in my car. Well, you could have it, because the OEM can create a sort of app store or feature store that you can just press, oh, I want to subscribe to this ADAS system for the next 2 weeks. You put in your credit card number, and poof, you suddenly have a new feature on your car. Or you could integrate the car with your life. So with your smart home appliances, you're driving home, it can open your garage door, it can put on the lights, it can start playing your favorite TV show, and also start dripping your coffee for you. So you can really start to integrate the car with your life. And this is what the OEMs are currently doing. You're not seeing it yet in the car in a very big scale, but this is what they are doing. In here, I was supposed to say that cars are getting smarter, but this would be a gross understatement. Cars are extremely smart. They have incredible amounts of different sensors and technologies, and they receive countless of gigabytes of data at all times. Also, they are getting more pervasively connected to online services. So this raises a new question in the automotive industry. How can you visualize all of this data in a concise manner without distracting the driver, and also all the while maintaining the brand identity of the OEM? In mobile industry or in smartphones, this is handled by apps. And basically, what it means that third-party service providers create apps that you can then get from app stores. It works great for mobile. But the thing is, each individual app is its own process created by the third-party service provider, and it has its own brand identity. So whether you use a Apple phone or, let's say, a Samsung phone, the UI of Facebook or Instagram is always the same, no matter which phone you use. And the problem is that this doesn't work in automotive, because in automotive, brand identity matters. So the two main reasons for why there's an app for that philosophy does not work is basically safety and brand identity. And safety is extremely important, because it is not possible for the driver to toggle around and try to find the app for the service that they need or the information that they need while driving, because that will cause accidents. Instead, the car UI itself needs to showcase all of the relevant data to the driver in a context-sensitive manner, which means that the UI needs to be adaptive to its environment so that it always showcases the data the driver needs at the moment the driver needs it. And when the driver doesn't need the data anymore, it doesn't visualize it anymore so that there is no clutter on the UI. And the second aspect is the brand identity. And I cannot say enough how important this is for the OEMs. They spend hundreds of millions, probably even billions of dollars every year for the design and branding. Because in automotive, UI is not a commodity. It is a differentiator. So it's extremely important for the OEMs that their UI, their interior, looks different from their competitors. Because this is how people make the decisions on if they buy the car or if they don't buy the car. Visualizing data in new ways is also important. ADAS technologies are already a reality. You can get a pretty good mid-priced car for not that much money that has a pretty good working ADAS system on it. But the problem is that the ADAS is usually not visualized. The visualization of the ADAS is lagging behind severely. So in most cases, for example, adaptive cruise control is visualized with just a light on a dashboard. Or it could be visualized like here, that there's a model of a car and it has a couple of lines, and they show you how far away from the other car you can get with the adaptive cruise control. In some more higher-end cars, we might have ADAS systems that actually visualize the car and a couple of lanes in 3D space. But this is, again, quite detached from reality, because this is an abstract 3D space. It's not reflecting the actual environment where the car is driving. So how do we go from here, where we have these sometimes pretty nice visualizations of data, to a world where we have actually all of the sensors and everything working together to paint the picture in the real world, to have the maps, have the ADAS inside the maps, and have the data inside the real world. So we might have all of the building blocks. We might have a good car and a good UI. We might have amazing maps that, for example, Mapbox provides. And we might have amazing services provided by multiple different service providers. But you just simply cannot put all of these together and expect to get a good user experience, because that is not the case. Instead, you still need all of these building blocks, but you need to connect them. You need to make sure that they are seamlessly interacting with each other. And this is how you create a great user experience. And this actually brings us to the fact why I'm here talking, because you might be wondering, like, why are you not talking about maps? Well, I will start talking about maps from now on. We have been working together with Mapbox, especially because Mapbox employees have been amazing to work with. And of course, their tech is pretty cool. And we have brought up a Kanzi Maps plugin that can basically take any map provider's map data and visualize it in Kanzi. So it's a plugin that brings map data and map design into Kanzi UI workflow. So what does this actually mean? Why is this significant? Well, basically, it brings the map component inside the Kanzi scene graph. So the map is rendered in the same scene graph as the actual UI is rendered in. And this means that there is a seamless integration of the map and the UI. Well, it's not actually even a seamless integration, but it actually takes and brings the map elements as UI elements. So you can create the same interaction for the map elements as you create for the UI elements. So for example, you have a building. You can make it clickable. What happens if I swipe here? What happens when a phone call comes? You can make everything conditional. You can customize the rendering of map depending on other dependencies in the UI. Also, you can rapidly prototype the map design and interaction. Well, you can prototype the map design already, let's say, with Mapbox Studio, which is an amazing tool. But you can, with Kanzi Maps, you can prototype it in the actual UI toolset scenario. So you can create these advanced prototypes in a matter of days where you have the UI and the maps working together. And again, the designers can truly iterate. They can check out if this works, this doesn't work, this works, this doesn't work, and go on through like this. So what does this actually mean? So the map becomes a seamless part of the UI. And it allows you to visualize any data from any source inside the maps. And it will also allow you to share the map data through all different screens that you have. And this is especially important because in the future, with the with these new technologies and when we want the cars to drive themselves, it is extremely important to visualize maps, and it actually becomes almost necessarily to visualize the maps better inside the cars. And it's only natural that the UI should start centering around the maps instead of just centering the map around the UI. And here are some examples of what we have actually done with the maps. So here's a video clip that one of my coworkers took from his PC. We had a couple of weeks ago a hackathon event at Rightver offices where we basically took gave everyone a day off and they could do whatever they wanted to. And my coworker decided to create this sort of implementation where he brought in Mapbox maps inside Kanzi Studio, created a little bit of a UI for it, and decided to write his own Kanzi engine plugin. And this plugin basically brings sun direction data from the cloud to the UI. And then depending on where you are in the world, so what latitude and longitude, what time of the day it is, the map actually reflects that reality inside the car. And all of this was done in like a matter of, what, 6-7 hours with a little power of Red Bull. So this just leads me to ask the question, what can you actually do when you have time to work with this? Then also other concepts that you can create or that we have been trying around with this is sort of like different types of visualization for data. So for example, in this example, we have the traffic information, but instead of just showing it in different color, we actually used particle systems to create these animated different effects for the traffic information. Or for example, visualizing point of interest data, like we do here. So we're only rendering the buildings that we want the driver to see, but then we're not rendering rest of the map because we know that it's not important for the driver at that very specific moment. So with all of these technologies, the only limitation there is the imagination of the designer. Whereas before in the automotive, the limitation used to be the actual tools. And that led to a lot of frustration for the designers because they had these amazing visions, they had the ideas, but they couldn't execute them because they didn't have the tools to do so, to actually deploy. So I want to go back to here. So this is basically the idea how we get. So this opens new avenues for basically getting real world into your actual UI. So for example, in this example, we have the actual maps with the buildings and with the actual lanes rendered. So instead of having the ADAS system in an abstract space, we have it in the actual real environment. So it becomes more easy to grasp for the driver. So in the beginning, I asked you, does the in-car navigation have to suck? And of course, the answer is no, it does not. But that is not the answer that we want. The real answer is that it cannot suck, because if we cannot, in an effective manner or way, visualize map where the car is, what the car is doing, and what the car wants to do, we cannot move on to autonomous driving, because there is not enough trust between the vehicle and the driver. And I think that was me, and I welcome you.
Thank you so much. I wish the maps looked that amazing in my car. all right, so before we jump into sort of like what's next and kind of frame that whole situation, I think sometimes we forget how far we've actually come. When the slides get loaded up here. When we talk about navigation and live location, there's been many milestones across the industry that have kind of brought us to this foundation that we have today. So I'd love to just take a moment, reflect and acknowledge kind of some of those moments, and this might bring back some memories from a few of these experiences that you might have come across. Thank you. So amazing, right? I mean, where we've been in just over a decade is really inspiring. And all of these kind of use cases of today and the user experiences are really pushing the boundaries for like where the industry is going and the technology that actually empowers them. So my background, I've been in automotive and transportation for 8 years now. And I've been lucky and fortunate to have touched a lot of different use cases across the driver and passenger. So I've been able to witness sort of this amazing transition from like manual driving to semi-autonomous and then to full autonomy, both from the in-car UX and mobile UX perspective. So I'm going to touch upon a few of these today briefly. So if you think about the live location platforms of today, they're really kind of creating these new user experiences at world scale. So you have the crazy sensor arrays that are coming, you know, built into these cars, and what that is enabling is just phenomenal. So this is really enabling hyper-local navigation in ways that we've never really experienced before. And so when we embarked on Autopilot at Tesla, so I ran the UI UX team over there for almost 6 years, and the car had been out for a few years before Autopilot came out. But in 2015, nothing was really out like this. So we had to start with a general concept and a philosophy. And it was really all about the safety field, right? All these sensors are supposed to give you a sense of confidence and safety. And as an object passes through that, it kind of deflects that safety field, and that would be indicated back to the driver. So the use cases and the vision was all about sort of end-to-end experience, right? And so if you think about a journey map, kind of starts your house, you summon the car, it meets you in the driveway, you get in your car, it navigates through complex intersections in the city, looking at lights and pedestrians and all that, acknowledging sort of windy roads, right, up in the mountains or on the coast, onto the highway, being able to change lanes, and then eventually being able to get off at the exit that you need to get off to. And then when you get to work, you can hop out of your car, and the car would go find a parking spot on its own and park itself. So this was all 2015, and this was the very first version of Autopilot, so I just want to play a quick clip of this to show a little bit of the UI and how that was weaved into the user story. This really changed the way that we looked at our commute and sort of the technologies that we expected by default when we get into these brand new cars that are offering so much that so much to offer. So what this really, malfunction on the mic here. What this really started to create was a duality between the micro and the macro. So if you think about the micro, that's exactly what we just saw, the Autopilot, 50 to 100 meters around the car, that's safety net, right? We've always had the macro as well, which is your trip overview. So what was interesting is from a UI perspective, we were considering both of them at the same time, how you could get information from one and the other and how they feed into one experience. So in the Model S, that was in the instrument cluster, we kind of had navigation to the left. Front and center was Autopilot and all the sensory capabilities. On the center display, massive display showing maps, our entire route overview, and all the context related to that, charging, POIs, et cetera. So that was a little bit on the driver, but what about the passenger? What does that mean in the autonomous world? So for live location and nav, we need new levels of transparency to accurately inform users and make them feel safe about what this car can and cannot do. So this is an image back from 2013 from a LiDAR scan at an intersection. This was about 750 megabytes of data in 1 second captured. So when I started thinking about autonomous from the passenger point of view, you know, we had to have a philosophy around sort of contextualize only what matters. And so when you think about out of that 1 second of data capture, what is useful for the car? It's definitely still a subset of the greater total of the point cloud, but for the user, it's even more of a fraction less than that. So you start to think about very carefully, what are the elements that you want to show and bring forward to the user? And I think this is really key because there's so much going on, but we have to direct focus, right? And if you're sitting in the back of an autonomous car that's driving you from A to B, the last thing that you're going to be doing is staring at the screen all the time, right? So there might be moments that you want to reflect, and you might be doing something, and you look back at the screen because the car has come to an abrupt stop. Well, why is that car stopping? Is it because the pedestrians come out in a trajectory path that matches where the car is going? Or is it because it stopped because of a red light? Is there a ball that somehow rolled out and been occluded and stuck underneath the car that you actually can't see? The next wave of user experiences will have tools that will allow us to kind of curate and direct these scenes better than ever. So this is like a quick study of like bringing in some of that data and visualizing it in a very abstract way, not trying to recreate the world around us, but in ways using this as a medium for expression. So I think in the future, brands will utilize this very much to kind of showcase their differentiators of how they bring this data to life and what that means for the user. So if you think about the on-trip experience, you know, for a passenger going into an autonomous car, you still have to get to that car. So you have this like pre, during, and after. And there's different aspects of that experience that might become of interest to that user. You might want to be kind of greeted, of course, when you get in the car after you put in the luggage, but then a sense of context as to where you're going. And then you kind of start the trip, right? And then during the riding, there's times where you want to get a sense of your overview, but then you also want to become aware and kind of educated as to what the cars can do. And then when you arrive, you have your final approach and potentially even exit instructions on which side to get out and where your destination may be. And then you have the walking destination, which you could use AR, for example, to kind of guide you to that final place. And so again, I just want to touch back on the macro and the micro. There are moments where you need both. And I think as designers and developers, we need to figure out what is the interplay between those two and how do they hand off to one another. So things that might be interesting to showcase, of course, trees, curves, and structures, the known hardscapes of the world. But then you've got more dynamic moving objects, cars, the bicycles, peoples, and animals, things that could come out from nowhere and the car would have to react to that. So this is where that salience comes into play. And then you've got sort of all the logic and the planning of the car, all the smart showing kind of the predictive route and avoidance and all of the exit cues and various other things. So all those combined kind of add up to something that can be a highly curated experience. And when you think about the framework of the data coming in from these sensors, right, they kind of start out as points, then as they become more interesting, they're kind of isolated and become blobs, right? And then they're categorized and then become objects. And eventually they kind of graduate all the way to actors or subjects. And then the visual techniques that we can use to kind of denote each one of those could be different, right? So they have different meanings. And so this might be an example of sort of what the sensors might see, but then, you know, how do we bring that back into the user experience? So autonomous experiences aren't always about being educated, right? This is a transition that we're going through. At some point, it's going to be more about celebrating the cities and also being able to personalize your experience in this vehicle that you might be sharing with other people. It could be friends, could be coworkers. So we're going to get to a point where it's going to be less about like seeing real-time information and more about enjoying kind of the whole reason why we wanted to potentially get in this car in the first place. So this is a proof of concept that I put together in January. It was like a two-week sprint just for myself to sort of figure out what is the end-to-end journey for something that might be, you know, a couple years down the road, where it's less of like a ride-sharing experience where it might just be you or a couple other people, but what about 6 to 8 people? So it's kind of like a little mini bus commuter. So here's one going through the financial district in San Francisco. And there might be new aspects of the experience that we want to expose, right? Maybe I've got a couple friends that are coming along for the ride, and I can actually accurately see their ETAs as they're coming along. And so here's a quick video that kind of showcases the end-to-end journey. So this was just a vision piece, right? But it was trying to put some feelers out there to kind of understand sort of what are those pre, during, and after moments. So these cars would be like highly situated around certain use cases, right? So maybe I want to get something done on the way to work, so I want to get the productivity suite. It's got a desk, some plug-ins, whatnot. Maybe another one is like more situated around a gym. So you've got a Peloton or something in there, and you can actually get a little workout on the way to work. So moving on to world scale guidance. This is pretty exciting, but most everybody has probably seen that image on the top left, right? It's the junction views that come up and the various GPS systems. And a while back, it was the way to try to virtually recreate that scene. It was never quite right. You know, they even put in fancy clouds and little buildings that went a little bit too skeuomorphic, but the meeting was still trying to root somebody in the moment and make them feel confident about where they needed to go by recreating that. But as with the announcement today, with the Mapbox Vision SDK, we're gonna finally have that augmented now in the real world. So you're gonna be able to see that turn-by-turn navigation in those moments where you need the utmost clarity. So how many of you guys have been in those situations where you're about to get off on an exit on the highway, and the navigation systems are all the way zoomed out, but you've got two rows that kind of go off in the same direction, right? The route line is so thick and it's rendered so poorly that it actually covers up the other road. So you can't even really tell where you're going unless, of course, you look at the turn-by-turn banner. But when you need to know the information, it's not always there for you. So one thing that I think about is also back into this kind of handoff between sort of the vector maps world and then the augmented world. How will they become counterparts to one another and kind of strengthen off of each other's pros? And when is the right moment to do that? What is the type of data that's going to be triggering that handoff? So when we think about multimodal, this is becoming more and more of the norm today. And these are some sketches. But you think about sort of food delivery. they got to navigate to a restaurant, but often they have to find parking. And that's not always available in the app. And then once they park, even if it was, they need to walk into the actual location. Sometimes there's a separate entrance for where you need to pick up your food. All that sometimes is not even available on the map. But tomorrow's services will be thinking about that level of detail when they get in, of course, pick up their items, and then get back on the road to go down to their customer. And then when it comes close to kind of dropping off that that package or food, there's going to be new tools available for drivers to almost see augmented like point of location where that that rider would be. So that's super exciting. And then,
like I said, I think that's all we have time for now.
Okay, I guess that's it.
I'm so sorry to seal him. Everybody, thank you so much to Brennan and Osa. I learned a ton. We're just going to have to do this again, right? They're so good.
Warm welcome. Thank you so much.